Another description is there called Nitya Anitya Viveka. You have to find out what is eternal, what is non-eternal. These two logics you consistently apply in your decision making in your life. You start tuning yourself to the Sakshi, the witness, rather than to the ego, Ahankara. So this is the teaching which comes from Master Shravana. Right? So that's how Master teaches you, Tattvamasi, you are that. You are consciousness, now you are getting influenced by the ego. So this is the method by which you can get out of the influence of ego, deconditioning process. This is the way how to escape the jail, the formula to escape the jail. It's called discrimination.
How does it fit anatma in this atma and atma? What is anatma?
Yeah. His question is, the two discriminations are two types. Nitya Anitya Viveka. What is eternal, what is not eternal? The self alone is eternal, the body, mind, complex and the world is not eternal. It's called Nitya Anitya Viveka. Atma Anatma Viveka means, Atma means, who am I? The Atma is consciousness. Anatma means matter. Okay, the body is matter, the mind is matter, the intellect is matter. Everything which is material in nature is called Anatma. But I don't feel I am material actually. I feel I am conscious. The body is conscious. I feel I am the body. This consciousness of the body is not your own. It is the consciousness of the self which is reflected on that. If this is your body, I am the body, you feel because I am alive, conscious. No, the body is matter. It's made out of the food essence. The food essence is nothing but mud.
So, Atma, other than Atma, all the essence is Anatma.
Yes. Anatma only. But you have to understand how to discriminate that. So this is the logic you learn. It's called Nitya Anitya Viveka and Atma Anatma Viveka. You have to apply it. Okay, master telling you is not sufficient. You have to apply it in your life. Right? So doctor gives you a prescription. Okay, you have diabetes. Take three tablets three times a day. Don't eat, take sugar. Okay? So that doesn't solve your problem. You have to follow the prescription. Nitya Anitya Viveka, Atma Anatma Viveka, you have to apply in your life every moment. Right? Without applying, no, I didn't realize Atma. How does it work? Nitya Anitya Viveka, you did apply? Atma Anatma Viveka, did you apply? I didn't realize myself. Who didn't realize yourself? Find out. Apply the Nitya Anitya logic and tell me who is that I you are speaking of. Oh, Guruji, I listened to all the scriptures, but I didn't realize. Then Guruji will ask you, who? Then you say, what Guruji, you only ask me who? So when Guruji asks who, he is asking you to apply the Nitya Anitya Viveka, Atma Anatma Viveka to find out who is speaking. The ego is speaking. Okay? So this is called Shravana. Is it end of life? The Shravana is sufficient for you? For very, 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 very evolved souls, Shravana is over. Shravana Matrena, they listened and understood and over. But for most of the people, Manana is required. What is Manana? The conviction that this is true. What is the conviction? I am Brahman. The conviction doesn't come easily. I am a miserable creature. Right? And you are calling me Brahman. Guruji says, okay, I'll take your words, but I'm still a miserable creature. No, Vedanta tells it. Okay, I respect Vedanta. I respect you, Guruji, also. But still, I'm a miserable creature. The conviction is missing. Shravana is over. Guruji has done his best attempt to explain to you in various ways. But you are not convinced. What does this Guruji know? He is already enlightened. He has no suffering at all in life. He doesn't understand what is suffering. And he is telling me, you are free from suffering. How? I am not convinced. And every day I go to home, I just have to see the same, the wife of my husband, my wife or husband, and then you understand what is misery. So, the conviction has not come. Understanding has come. Shravana has given you understanding. Oh, I am Brahman. Okay, that's good about it. Shivoham. Yes, very good. So, I have understood. Now, I am not convinced about it. Why you are not convinced about it? Why there is no conviction? Guruji, I believe you. I trust you. Guruji, our scriptures I believe. But still I am not convinced. And Guruji, please, you are saying apply Viveka and Nitya Nitya Viveka and Atma Anatma Viveka. Just stand in front of my husband or wife, then you will understand how difficult it is. Practical situation in life will bring out a lot of objections to this thing, right? Objection to Jnana. Now, this objection has to be overruled or objection has to be resolved. Okay? And then you have to do some homework. Guruji has done his homework to become what he is. Your homework you have to do. Manana. Manana means what is required to convince yourself, you have to do. How do you convince yourself? You go and ask another sadhaka, another friend. Hey, you got Atmadana, you have got enlightened? Tell me how. That doesn't work. Oh, that person looks very peaceful. See, that bearded fellow is sitting there. He is so peaceful. He must be enlightened. I will ask him, what is that your secret? Please tell me, what is the secret sauce? Manana is not that. Manana is, there is a logic in Vedanta. Why they teach you your Atma? Okay, there is a very clear logic. There is a clear understanding. This is not a logic of the material world. This is called Nyaya. The logic of consciousness. They're not logic of objects. Logic of a subject. So the logic of the subject, you may have to go through to understand why Guruji is telling or Vedanta is telling, I am Brahman. Okay? All your life you have learnt logic from the society. That's called worldly logic. The material logic. The real logic called Nyaya, which tells you I am Atma, which will, various objections or various doubts will come, that has to be resolved through this logic. Okay? Shastra, the Shravana, the Guruji, Guru tells the teaching of Jnana, Tattvamasi, he gives through some Shastra. It's called Shastras oriented to Shravana. The scriptures oriented to Shravana. Means to tell you are that. The Manana is now deeper level, second level analysis. Anything which you have missed out in that, any doubts to come, you have to apply this. The Shastras relate to Manana. One Shastra is called Upadesha Shastri. Okay, so now there are various ways the logically your doubts are clarified so that your mind becomes free from doubts. Mind means intellect, right? A intellect which is convinced is very powerful. It can take control of the mind. But intellect which is actually doubtful, okay? Why you are not convinced about Atmadana, I am Brahman? Because certain doubts will come to you. That's called Manana. Okay? So Manana related scriptures you have to study. Specific scriptures are there. It's not I'll do wholesale study of something. There are specific scriptures dedicated to Manana. Okay? So then comes in the Manana there are some siddhis. Siddhis means not magical powers. Siddhis means what happens when you realize. Okay? The state of a realized being. So those things you have to study. Sthita Pradna or enlightened, why he is and what he is and why he is. You have to study. It is like somebody wants to become an actor, good actor, he has to study how a good actor is performing. A good sportsman has to study the nature of the way another sportsman plays. Like that, you have to study what is a realized person, but don't go to so many mythological stories because there is a lot of corruption in that. Okay? So enlightened person is magical. He is magical. Just he touches like this and you'll get enlightened. Okay, he sees like this, something will happen. He walks on water. So many stories are there. Don't get trapped in those stories. Go to the critical Vedantic text which teaches you what is a state of Jnani and why is the state of Jnani. Something like Naishkarma Siddhi. Okay, so these are the things which you have to study during Manana. Contemplate on that. To get conviction yourself, you have to be convinced what is truth. Not because Master said, not because Vedanta says. You have to convince yourself this is the truth. That's stage of manana. So now this has addressed the buddhi and ahankara. Ahankara and buddhi is addressed now. Mind has four functions. Manas, buddhi, ahankara, chitta. Buddhi and ahankara is addressed. Now buddhi has become stronger. Whatever ego says is now applies discrimination. Ego is becoming weaker. Now the other way comes into picture. Chitta, the thoughts, subconscious impressions will pop up. You are saying, Brahman, I know how stupid you are. Now 2 years back, do you remember what you did? Impressions will come up. Buddhi, intellect has understood clearly. The conviction has come. Now some vasanas will come. So these vasanas have to be addressed. The jnana has to go deeper into your subconscious. And this process of going deeper into subconscious is called nididhyasa. Nididhyasa leads to two types of samadhi called savikalpa and nirvikalpa, antar samadhi and bahi samadhi. Totally four types of samadhi. So by practicing this, your vasanas will reduce. Okay? Samadhi does not give you jnana. Okay? People may think that, oh, that sage, the saint is sitting in samadhi for 10 years and he got some jnana because of that. Nobody got jnana because of samadhi. Jnana only got digested during samadhi. Jnana came through shravana. The clarity which came out through shravana. And the doubts which came out through, came in shravana, you got clarified in manana. And finally, again to nididhyasa to go into push out some of the vasanas which are there. So, purpose of nididhyasa or samadhi is to remove some of vasanas which are pending. So, mind four functions are there: manasu, buddhi, ahankara, chitta. Manas is external sense organs. Buddhi is intellect. So, buddhi and manas are not affected. They are like that. Buddhi has become sharper because of discrimination. Ahankara has become weaker. Okay. And chitta has become purified because of the nididhyasa practices. Nididhyasa practice also called sahaja samadhi or aham brahmasmi or sohamasmi type of meditations. So now these will weaken your vasanas. And this is how one gets established in truth. How much time is there? And 10 minutes. So, nididhyasa, I'll tell you, manana, there are some issues I'll tell you. So, the teaching of Vedanta, you are Brahman, I am conscious, somehow I can accept it. You are Brahman, Brahma Satya, that's also fine. Jagat Mithya, the world is unreal. How can you say that world is unreal? See, just now I fell down and there is a wound here. I am hurt. Is this unreal? How? I have to go to doctor. I have to go to real doctor. Unreality of the world is you are not convinced. If you are not convinced about unreality of the world, the mind cannot accept aham brahmasmi as reality. They are simultaneous. I am Brahman and world is unreal has to be clear. Because if the world is also real, then the world is troubling me. The trouble is coming from the world. Brahman doesn't trouble me. Okay? The world, I am getting troubled. So I need to understand the unreality of the world. That's called Jagan Mithya. That conviction has to come. How does that conviction come? Through teaching of listening to scriptures of manana. Okay? Brahma Satya, Jagan Mithya. So this conviction has to come. This is called manana. Then nididhyasa is to remove some of the vasanas. So then, what is realization? Tell me what is realization. I understood all those things. How do I get enlightened? What is the enlightened experience? See, I read so many books. That sage says, I got enlightened experience. This got enlightened experience. This sage got enlightened experience. Tell me what is that enlightened experience? I will get it. How to get that? You tell me. There's a secret. Enlightenment is not an experience. Any experience will come and go. Enlightenment will not come and go. Enlightenment experience, not an experience. Oh, what about that sage? He saw light there. He saw a wonderful divine light. That experience came and went. Enlightenment has nothing to do with that experience. Enlightenment is purely the clarity which has emerged in your intellect, so that your intellect aligns with the Atma rather than the ego. So if it aligns with the Atma, intellect is completely balanced state. It's called sthirapradna. Because Atma has nothing to know, nothing to take and give and take from the world. Raga Dvesha doesn't affect Atma. It is samasthiti, it is sakshi. Okay? Somebody comes and shouts at you. Ego says, hey, this fellow is shouting, you shout back or chase this fellow out. Okay, ego will say, because ego has a take. Sakshi will say, he is shouting, good. Somebody comes and praises you, the Sakshi will say, very good. Neither, it accepts everything. The self accepts, self is a state of total acceptance of life. So ego, intellect starts aligning with the Sakshi rather than the ego. Are you clear? And this is not what you call as experience. It's a state of deep insight into life, which leads you to the peace. The raga dvesha does not affect you. Dukeshu anudigmanaha sukeshu vigatasprah vita raga bayakrodaha stitadi munirchate. Somebody who is not affected by raga dvesha, attraction, repulsion. Okay? Sukha, dukkha, happiness and unhappiness, bhaya, krodha, anger and fear is not affected. Does it mean that there is no fear rises in his mind? Does it mean there is no anger in his mind? It may rise, but the discriminating intellect will say, keep quiet, peaceful. So, a state of enlightenment is called no mind state. From mind you have gone to no mind. Oh my God, if I get no mind, what will happen to me? How do I operate in the world? I know, I have heard people who are no mind state in some places like hospitals. No mind, Sri Ramana Maharshi calls, it's a mano nasha. Oh my God, my mananasha happens. What will happen? What will I do? Huh? I have a family to take care. I have a job to take care. Mananasha, dead mind. The mananasha here, the mind has four functions. Manas, buddhi, ahankara, chitta. The ahankara becomes weak or disappears. Okay? The ahankara is influencing the buddhi, intellect. Now that disappears. Your buddhi will work very sharply now. Very clearly. Your intellect will work more clearly. Mananasha means not the mind becoming dull or destroying the mind, rather the intellect working more clearly in the presence of the Sakshi. Okay? It is ahankara becoming weaker or disabling. Oh, the sage has no ahankara, ego? Of course he has ego. The sage also has ego. If there is no ego, he cannot operate his body. He cannot operate his vehicle. But this ego, okay, ego, earlier, anybody's, the person's ego says, I am the body, I am the mind, I am the intellect. The ego of the sage says, I have a body, I am possessing the body, mind, intellect, but I am the self, Atma. The ego is started singing a new tune, new to the new master, which is Sakshi. So if you talk to a sage, say, Mahatma, I am doing Namaskara, he'll say, bless you. Okay. So he says, I ate food. Then you'll ask, how Atma ate food? Atma doesn't eat food. Sakshi doesn't eat food. Okay. But sage says, I ate food. Sage says, I ate food because he is able to use that I depending on the context. So when he says, I ate food, he says, this body required food, ate food. But then he says, Shivoham. That means The I which I am saying is not the body, mind, and intellect. I am consciousness. Depending on the context, he uses the right I. Whereas an ignorant person mixes up all I's. Okay? So manonasha doesn't mean destruction of the mind. Manonasha means destruction of the ignorance in the mind. Destruction of the ignorance means destruction of the ignorance in the ahankara, ego. Ahankara associating myself with the body, mind, and intellect. That body, mind, and intellect is replaced by consciousness, Brahman. So now, there is a knowledge which arises. The knowledge is called Aham Brahmasmi. I am Brahman. Okay? Where does it come? It comes in the intellect only. Okay? Earlier, the intellect was deciding, I am the body, mind, and intellect under the influence of ego. Now, intellect says, I am Brahman, Shivoham. Okay? Doesn't mean that sage will keep on saying, but that basic thought process, that basic understanding will be there in the background of all his activities. So the ego of a sage is a burnt ego. It has no more power to cause disturbance. But ego is there. Okay, for operational purpose, functional purpose. So out of manas, buddhi, ahankara, jitta, four functionalities, the manas, the sense organs are functioning. Which is mind is functioning to sense organs. But now, whatever he sees through the sense organs, for a sage, he understands the unreality of the world. Okay? Whereas for a not realized person, he sees through sense organs and sees it as real. A sage sees through the manas of the sage. Seeing through the sense organs, the world appears like you, like it appears to you or me. So nothing happens to his eyes. There's no surgery done to the eyes. No, nothing happens to ears. All those functionality will be there, but interpretation by the buddhi will be different. Interpretation by the intellect is different. Earlier, intellect will interpret it as reality. Now, the intellect of a sage interprets as unreal. Why did it happen? Because of the shravana, manana, nidhyasa. Interpretation has changed. The world which appears to be real to you, they appears as unreal to the sage. Even though both the eyes, ears function similarly, only interpretation changes in the buddhi, intellect. Okay? So Jagan Mithya is experience. Then I am Brahman, Aham Sat is also a thought arises, just like I am the body, mind, and intellect thought arises in us. So this is what is called enlightenment. It's not a new experience, but it's a deep insight which has purified the intellect, and the purified intellect is the enlightenment. Word enlightenment means light. Who needs light? The self doesn't need light. Self has never, doesn't need light at all. The light is only for the mind. And the mind which gets purified, illuminated is called enlightened mind. So enlightened mind, the moment he gets enlightened, okay, nothing happens to the eyes and ears of the sages. The world suddenly looks some other dimension will open up. No. The same world, what you see, the same table or chair, you think it is real. The sage thinks it's unreal. But he'll use the table and chair appropriately for the occasion. He doesn't go and bump into the wall because wall is unreal. Okay? So he understands the Maya. Okay, it's almost like a sage in a situation. You are in a virtual reality show. Where in virtual reality show you're seen. You're sitting in a chair car and suddenly the chair will jump. I mean, you feel as if you're falling from a mountain. All are simulations, but nothing is real. So world sage understands all this, what you are seeing, experience the world is nothing but a virtual reality simulation. So now he enjoys it. While you suffer, he enjoys it. See, it's like a movie. You start suffering because you think movie is real. The sage understands this is a movie and he starts enjoying. So that's why a sage is called Mahabhogi. When he experiences the world, he starts, bliss will be there all the time. The state of the sage is called Mahabhogi. Everything he experiences in the world, he enjoys it. Whereas for us, enjoyment is always with the conditions apply. Right? This is the state of Jnani. This time is out. So, okay. I just will close this and then ask questions. Right? So far I told you the process of Jnana. Okay, the process of jnana, atma jnana, because we have a lot of concepts, it's ultimately a pure intellect flowering. Right now your intellect is conditioned by the society. The unconditioning process of the intellect is called enlightenment. There is a logic for that, there is an understanding for that, there is a teaching for that. And that unconditioned intellect is called enlightenment. And it's not an experience. Because experience come and go, enlightenment doesn't come and go. Because before enlightenment you are the self, after enlightenment you are the self, during your ignorance also you are the self, but only you didn't know. So enlightenment doesn't, a state of jivan mukti, liberation, doesn't come and go. Okay? What comes and goes, what comes will go. Jivan mukti doesn't come and go because you are never bound. Only intellect and mind created illusion that you are bound. Created illusion that you are a body, mind and intellect. That disappears and you realize I am Brahman, I am pure consciousness and the world is just an appearance in my consciousness. So that understanding becomes deep-rooted in the mind. Okay? So this is the process of jnana. Any questions are there?